Welcome to lecture 9 in this lecture series on inverse problems. And last week I introduced you to regularization. And since this is one of the main concepts in inverse problems, let me rehearse this and also give you some more examples. We started by the general regularization and then switched to regularization, which is based on the singular value decomposition. And that's defined as K alpha plus G. Let me show you this. Yeah, this is K alpha plus G is defined as sum over all K J alpha of sigma K times G scalar product with VK times UK. And G alpha is a function from R plus to R plus. Okay, for the G alpha, we require that G alpha of sigma goes to 1 over sigma for alpha going to 0. And this is quite understandable. I mean, if that happens, then the coefficients here converge to 1 over sigma k, and in a way that already converges to the minimum norm solution, k plus g. Then we require that g alpha of sigma is, for fixed alpha, is bounded above by some constant c alpha, and sigma times g alpha of sigma is bounded from above by some constant c independent of alpha and sigma. We already showed that two very common choices for regularization functionals fit into this scheme, and that was Tikhonov regularization, where g alpha of sigma is chosen as sigma over alpha squared plus sigma squared, and c alpha, which is in fact the operator norm of k alpha plus, is 1 over 2 alpha, and then truncated SVD, where g alpha of sigma is chosen as 0 for sigma smaller than alpha, and 1 over sigma for sigma larger than alpha, and it's not here, but in this case c alpha is 1 over alpha, of course. Okay, the two are fundamentally different, because if you look at the definition, then truncated SVD can only be performed if the SVD is known, and everything in the series has actually to be computed. So in the sense of what I said before, that we should avoid using the SVD itself, this is not an optimal algorithm. On the other hand, we showed that Tikhonov regularization is actually the minimizer of a different problem, and that minimizer can be computed directly. And so there's no need for the SVD here, and in this sense, it is a good algorithm. Okay, based on these assumptions on G alpha, we could prove that first of all, the operator norm of K alpha plus is bounded by C alpha. That's what I just mentioned. And we have that for alpha going to 0 and G in the domain of K plus, we actually have K alpha plus G converges to K plus G for alpha going to 0. In the next lemma, corollary, we proved that alpha of delta and g delta is any parameter of selection function that goes to 0 for delta going to 0, and delta times k alpha of delta g delta plus goes to 0 as well. Then we could prove that alpha and k alpha is a regularization. We did that by using the following split. Yeah, need to find my mouse. Using the following split. So if we set alpha equal to alpha of delta and g delta for ease of notation, then we have k alpha g delta minus k plus g can be split up into one error that depends on the data and one error that depends on that is due to the fact that we're using the wrong operator, that we're using k alpha plus instead of k plus. Okay, let me introduce you to yet another form of regularization. And now remember that k plus g for g in the domain of k plus is defined as the sum over all k, 1 over sigma k, g and vk times uk. The problem is that sigma k goes to 0, so this one over here gets large, and that's what we try to prevent in the Tikhonov regularization. However, there's a simpler way of preventing this from going to zero. Since the sigma k are all positive, we might also add an alpha down here. So if we define k alpha plus g as sum over all k, 1 over sigma k plus alpha, g scalar product with vk times uk, then this is again a regularization scheme that fits into our blueprint above, using J alpha of sigma equal to 1 over sigma plus, setting J alpha of sigma equal to 1 over sigma plus alpha. And in this case, you find, of course, that this is bounded from above by 1 over alpha, and everything, all the g alpha of sigma are smaller than 1, so we can set c equals to 1. And it's not here, but of course for alpha going to 0, this goes to 1 over sigma. And let me write this down. For alpha going to 0. So it has all the qualities that we require, and we already know that k alpha plus converges for alpha going to 0, converges to k plus on the domain of k plus. And also we have, like before, a regularization scheme with a proper parameter selection function. Okay, question, of course, is this an operator that can be computed without actually computing the SVD? So can this be computed on the operator itself? And let me show you that it is, for one very simple example. Assume for a second that K is self-adjoint, so we have X equal to Y. It's a positive semi-definite, and the range of the range of K is dense in X, which means that its closure is X itself. Now, since K is self-adjoint, we have K equal to K adjoint, so K in K adjoint is the same as K adjoint K is K squared. So that means all the singular values, and so that means all the singular vectors are the same. And that means we can write our operator k as ku equals to sigma of sum of all k, sigma k, u and uk times uk. Okay, on the other hand, if the range of k is dense in X, then we can also write any G from X as the sum over all KG scalar product with UK times UK. And for that case, let's compute K plus alpha I times K alpha plus G. Now, I didn't really compute this, but that's going to be easy, I hope. K plus alpha I mean, K. Can be, let me write this. Now, k plus alpha I, that k alpha plus g, that means that then we get here the sum over all k, sigma k, k alpha plus g. Scalar product with uk times uk. And of course, we have that alpha times k alpha, alpha times k alpha plus g, we can express it in the orthonormal system UK. And so this is nothing but alpha times the sum over all UK scalar product of k alpha plus g with UK times UK. And now if you insert the definition of k alpha plus g, then you find that first of all, we have that this is the same, maybe I should write this down, sum over all k, sigma k plus alpha times k alpha plus g, and I don't insert it now, scalar product with UK times UK. And now you insert the definition of K alpha plus G, which is this one over here. Observe that UK are an orthonormal system. So this one over here gives sigma, gives 1 over sigma K plus alpha times G and VK, and VK is UK, so the sigma K plus alpha goes away, and this is nothing but sum over all K, G and UK times UK, and if the UK are dense, then this is nothing but G. Okay, so our K alpha plus G, which we defined, solves the equation K plus alpha I times K alpha plus G is G, and so by solving this equation, we do the same as for Lavrentiev regularization. Okay, so this is also a kind or type of regularization which, at least in this simple case, can be performed using not using the SVD. Okay, the next idea is we could use iterative regularization, which means that we use an iterative process to compute the minimum norm solution. Now, one idea might be we could solve the normal equation with a known iterative algorithm. And there are a lot of iterative algorithms that come into mind. You could use conjugate gradient. The one we'll look at here is Landweber, but if you look in the literature, then many people are actually taking conjugate gradient. The analysis is completely different because in that case, that cannot be expressed by the SVD, but with Landweber, we are lucky and we can actually express the Landweber iteration using using SVDs. Yes. I hope that you are familiar with the Landweber iteration from something like numerical linear algebra. And what you're doing is we have the normal equation k star k u equals to k star g. And this one we solve using Landweber iterations. So the corresponding equation then is un plus 1 is un minus omega k star k un minus g. And well, the un are define a series, a sequence in x. And it's well known that at least in finite dimensions, that converges to the minimum norm solution. That's something you usually prove in numerical linear algebra. We want to use this here for an infinite dimensional operator. So, let me mention one thing first. I lost it. Yeah, there it is. Let me mention one thing first. If it converges at all, then it's clear that it converges to a solution of the normal equation, because I mean, if this becomes stationary, there's only one way this works. The second part over here must be zero, and providing omega is not 0. In fact, we will choose it as a number between 0 and 2 over sigma 1 squared. Provided that is the case, k star k u must be equal to k star g. So that must be a solution of the normal equation, right? So if it converges at all, then everything's fine. Then it will converge to a solution of the normal equation. So it will converge to a least square solution. Okay, now we want to write this down in terms of the singular value decomposition. So assume that UN has a representation of in terms of the UK from the singular system of K, and assume that it can be represented as sum of all K beta K N G and VK times UK. Now, first of all, we'll restrict ourselves to doing the iterations in the range of the operator K and in the range of K adjoint, and all elements, all vectors, all functions in that space can be expressed in this way. Now let's look at what happens if we plug in this representation of UN into the iterative sequence. First of all, there's a K star K UN. We know what happens if K star K is applied to some UK. It's just multiplied with sigma K squared. There's an omega over here. So K star K UK would be something like omega sigma k squared, so beta k n g and vk times uk. This un over here, that gives us another beta k n g of vk times uk. So we have something like 1 minus omega squared, omega sigma k squared, that's un minus omega k star k u times g of vk times uk. Okay, and the last thing we have is something like that omega k adjoint applied to g over here. And of course, we use the representation. That we derived of the adjoint. So we write g as the sum of all g times vk, g scalar product with vk times vk. Plus some element in the null space of K adjoint. Now, if we apply K adjoint to this, then what comes out is something like omega sigma scalar product of G and VK times UK. So we've been doing this many times now. So we arrive at a representation of un plus 1 in the same term as above. And of course, we see how we'll have to choose the beta k n plus 1. So this is obviously to be chosen as 1 minus omega sigma n squared beta k n plus omega times sigma. So we have an explicit representation of the Landweber scheme in terms of the singular value decomposition. Now, let's resolve this this recursive scheme. And then, of course, we find that beta k n plus 1 is sum over from L equals to 0 to sum over L from 0 to n, 1 minus omega sigma k squared to the power of L times omega times sigma k. There's a k missing over here. Why is that the case? Well, we start with 0, then we have omega times sigma k, then this gets multiplied by this one over here, and an omega sigma k is added, and now for each n, for each iteration in n, we get one more of this factor plus 1 omega sigma k, so this is the correct formula that we have here. Okay, so now let's set this to qk. And then we can apply the series formula for the geometric series. And so this is nothing but 1 minus qk to the n plus 1 over omega times sigma k squared. So this is 1 minus q n plus q to the n plus 1 over 1 minus qn. Qk, excuse me. And then we have an omega of sigma k over here. And multiplying, dividing by omega, there's a sigma here. We have 1 minus qk to the n plus 1 times 1 over sigma n. Of course, we want this to converge to 1 over sigma k for fixed k. So we require that qk, the absolute value of qk, is smaller than 1. Okay, so we first observe that, my mouse is gone. Oh, it's back. We first observe that all the singular values are between 0 and sigma 1. So, no, it's not. It should be like this. Are between 0 and sigma 1. And so if we choose omega smaller than 2 over sigma 1 squared, then obviously this over here is in the range of minus 1 to 1. So we have that the absolute value of qk is smaller than 1. And this is something that I require from now. Maybe I should mark this. Doesn't let me do that. Probably it doesn't like the color. So that's a requirement from now on. Okay, now we want to get to some kind, how does that fit into our scheme? There was also always an alpha in our scheme that went to 0. And now we have just an n in there, right? So the idea is this one converges to 1 over sigma k for n large. So let's put n equal to the largest integer that is smaller than 1 over alpha. And then alpha going to 0 means that n goes to infinity, right? And this is also something I will use from now on. Okay, define g alpha of sigma as 1 minus 1 minus omega sigma squared to the n plus 1 over sigma. That's just the formula that we already had up here, right? Then if we define k alpha plus as the sum of the k from 0 to infinity, j alpha of sigma, j and vk times uk, then this is just the nth iteration of Landweber, where n is equal to 1 over alpha, right? Okay, so this is again something we can really compute. It doesn't have to be done on the singular value decomposition. Okay, now we have that g alpha. Now let's look at it with our toolkit. And we have that g alpha of sigma goes to 1 over sigma. That's true, right? I mean, if we have, let alpha go to 0, then n goes to infinity, and this over here goes to 1 over sigma. Did I say 0? It converges to 1 over sigma. Since this converges to 0, this converges to 1 over sigma. Then sigma times g alpha of sigma, well, all that's left is this part over here. Well, the thing is that this over here might be negative, but we can estimate it as 1 plus the absolute value of 1 minus omega sigma squared to the n plus 1, which is smaller than 2, because again, 1 minus omega sigma squared is its absolute value is smaller than 1. Then again, g alpha of sigma, which is in fact, and now I'm going back to the sum representation which we had up here. is the sum from L from for L from 0 to n 1 minus omega sigma k squared times omega times sigma k. Now all of these over here are smaller than 1, and I should do this with absolute value, probably, yeah. Absolute value. And times, so this is then smaller or equal, times omega times sigma k. Now this is smaller than 1. So even there's an L missing. When this is smaller than 1, then this is bounded from above by 1, of course. This is omega. This is sigma k. The sigma k's are bounded from above by sigma 1. So this is less or equal than n plus 1 times omega times sigma 1. And again, this is something that only depends on n for a fixed operator. Okay, so we have all of our conditions satisfied, and in particular we have that the norm of the regularization operator is bounded from above by C alpha equal to 1 n plus 1, which is 1 over alpha plus 1 times omega times, well, sigma 1, which is actually the norm of K. Okay, and that means that Landweber iteration in this form over here defines a regularization scheme. And provided we use a parameter selection rule that satisfies these conditions over here. And let me just remark, what does that finally mean? You give me an error level delta, and then I choose an alpha. That parameter selection rule selects an alpha, and the alpha corresponds to 1n, so it's n is 1 over alpha, and the regularization is finally stop the iteration at the nth step, right? So at the nth iteration step, we stop everything. So the idea is here we stop prematurely in a way. We don't let it converge towards some limit. That would finally give us k plus g, but we know that it's either non-existent or not continuously dependent on g, so we don't want that. And the idea behind this iterative scheme is do not let the algorithm converge, but stop before that. Okay. A second idea that you could have with iterative regularization is something that we'll be using with the computer tomography algorithms, and that's where we'll introduce the Kaczmarz algorithms, and there this is really used. And suppose we have the inverse problems Ku equals G, and assume you already have some approximation UK for the quantity you want to measure. Okay, so we want to improve on that. So we said UN plus 1 equals to UN plus some DN. Obviously, we then have K times, or we need to solve the problem, KUN plus DN is G, because we want UN plus 1 to be a solution to the inverse problem. So we arrive at the problem KDN is G minus KUN. Now, this is an inverse problem for DN. It might not have a solution, but the simple idea would be, well, why don't we determine some regularized solution DN for exactly this problem? And we might do that. We could use Kaczmarz or whatever algorithm to compute a DN that solves this problem in a way. And set un plus 1 equal to un plus dn. And that's more or less exactly the idea that's behind Kaczmarz that we'll be tackling, as I said, in the CT section. In the homeworks, you will look at this problem for Tikhonov regularization. So you will answer the question, what happens if we choose Tikhonov as the regularized solution here? And you would show that this is, in fact, gives and defines a regularization.